Born David Gruen in 1886, David Ben-Gurion was one of 11 children. When he was just 3 years old, his grandfather taught him how to speak Hebrew. He also read him the stories of the Bible, the book that would shape Ben-Gurion's views throughout his life.
For him, the Bible is the essence of our life. It's the story of the Jewish people. He loved the prophets. He loved the prophets in the Bible. He loved the language of the Bible. For him, the Bible was the essence of the Jewish people. And it's not only that he knew the Bible from front to back, he knew it, he lived it. In many times where I saw him talking to people and talking to rabbis, he knew the Bible better than they knew it. And it was fascinating.
During his life, Ben-Gurion would learn several languages. But for him, there was only one language and one land for the Jewish people.
The Hebrew is the language of the Bible. He wanted to go back to the language. He wanted that we will go back, that the nation will go back to Hebrew.
As a teenager, he started his own Zionist group called the Ezra Society, named after the Israelite scribe who led the Jews back to Jerusalem after the Babylonian exile. Their goal was to promote the study of Hebrew.
That was his dream, as many as people as possible to teach them, especially the young ones. Let's teach Hebrew, that's our language.
The group also promoted the idea of Aliyah, moving to Palestine to build a Jewish homeland. That idea didn't go over well with the local Orthodox Jews.
For them, it's God took, God will give. The Almighty is the one who's responsible for the destruction of the Israel 2,000 years ago. So it's the Almighty that will give the state of Israel, nobody else.
In 1903, Zionist leader Theodor Herzl proposed the creation of a Jewish homeland in Uganda, a response to the violent pogroms in Russia. Herzl's followers around the world were outraged by the idea, including Ben-Gurion and his friends in the Ezra Society. They wrote a letter of protest to the World Zionist Organization.
We have reached the conclusion that the only way to fight Ugandaism is to make Aliyah.
For young Ben-Gurion, Aliyah was more than just an idea. It was a mission. And at the age of 19, he boarded a ship bound for the Holy Land.
In 1906, the day that he lands in Jaffa, happiest day of his life.
That happiness was soon tempered by reality. In 1906, the villages of Palestine were dominated by Arabs, and the founding of the first kibbutz was still 3 years away. The only places for Jewish immigrants to go were a few settlements started by Baron Rothschild.
He had a problem with these 13 settlements.
The work was not done by the Jews. The work was done by the Arabs.
In order to own the land, you've got to work the land. If you work the land, you own it. If someone else works it, he owns it. That's his belief. He has a conviction about it.
And he put that conviction to the test. Work was scarce, so Ben-Gurion took jobs wherever he could find them. Carrying manure in the orange groves, stomping grapes in the vineyards, or hauling boulders and plowing fields in the Galilee.
It was very hard for him. Physical labor was very, very, very hard. He was not a very strong man. He was not the healthiest person, the most athletic person as a kid, etc. But he survived. He had a belief, he had a will, and he worked through it. When I grew up and I started to learn about it and to hear about it, I always looked at him and I said, my God, if he could do it, what about us, you know?
I wandered from settlement to settlement. My clothes in tatters, my body on the edge of breakdown from famine. I quickly succumbed to malaria. A doctor said I would never shake the disease, and that for me, staying in Palestine, meant death. But I wrote to my father. There is no going back to the old life.
After 4 years of physical labor, Ben-Gurion moved to Jerusalem to help publish a Hebrew newspaper. It was at this time that he and his friends decided to change their names, and Gruen became Ben-Gurion, which means son of the lion in Hebrew.
It's a systematic way of thinking. Language, Hebrew. Work, Hebrew. The next thing is Hebrew names. You'll ask me, who is Joseph Ben-Gurion? Joseph Ben-Gurion was the Minister of Defense of Jerusalem when Jerusalem fell to the hands of the Romans. And he insisted afterwards, when the State of Israel was built, if your name was Manishevitz or was something like this, he would come to you and say, why have you got this Manishevitz? Don't you have a Hebrew name for that? In the Israeli army, when it was developed, anybody who went from a major to a higher rank had to change his name to a Hebrew name. That's him. This is the old and this is the new, and he was creating the new.
In Jerusalem, Ben-Gurion soon realized that the Jews had no hope of a state without a leader.
Once I asked him, I said, what is it? You woke one day and I said to him, you woke one day and decided that you want to build a country? I said, if anybody would tell me that on the street, I would say that he's a lunatic. He says, Alon, when I had questions and nobody could give me the answers, that's when I decided I've got to give the answers.
At the time, Palestine was part of the Ottoman Empire, so Ben-Gurion spent 3 months learning Turkish. Then he went to law school in Istanbul with plans to represent Jewish Palestine in the Ottoman government. But his plans were interrupted by the outbreak of World War I. The Turks entered the war on the German side, and in Palestine they singled out the Jews, whom they accused of siding with the British. Ben-Gurion was one of several Jewish leaders who were rounded up and expelled. He sailed for New York, where he met his wife, a young nurse named Paula. They would be married until her death 50 years later.
She was the boss. Paula had a very, very, very tough life, a very, very tough life. She dedicated her life to him, to take care of him. The economic situation was not very, very strong in the house. So Paula, for example, as a mother, she used to save money, buying food only for the kids, and she did not eat. So there was some time that she was malnutrition as a mother. And you hear it, this is the wife that later became the wife of the prime minister. How can it be? Well, that's how it was. You know, he knew where his government is. He knew where his army is, but he didn't know where his slippers are. She knew where it is. He knew that there is going to be pajamas on the bed, but he didn't know where they're coming from. So he was building a country, she built a family.
After the war, Ben-Gurion moved back to Palestine, now under the British mandate. For the next 3 decades, he devoted his life to preparing for statehood, and soon he became the undisputed leader of the Jewish national movement. He helped organize a new labor union called the Histadrut, which functioned as a pre-state Jewish government. The union supervised massive waves of immigration, plus the creation of hospitals, schools, sanitation, and public works. But more Jewish immigrants meant more trouble with the Arabs. In 1920, widespread Arab riots rocked Palestine, and the British did little or nothing to stop them. So the Jewish leaders created their own underground army to protect their people. It was called the Haganah, which means defense in Hebrew. This paramilitary group would later form the core of the Israeli Defense Forces. Over time, the violence between Arabs and Jews escalated. And in 1936, the British sent a committee to investigate the so-called Palestine problem. Several Arab and Jewish leaders were called to testify before the Peel Commission, and Ben-Gurion was among them.
Mr. Ben-Gurion, may I ask you a question? Where were you born?
In Plonsk.
Where's Plonsk?
Poland.
Very strange indeed. All the Arab leaders who have appeared before us were born in Palestine. Most of the Jewish leaders who appeared before us were born in Eastern Europe. The Arab people have an Ottoman land deed entitling them to this land. Do you have a document saying Palestine belongs to you?
This is my document. It is the most highly respected book. And I believe that you, British, respect it also. Our right in Palestine is not derived from the mandate or the Balfour Declaration. It is prior to that. The Bible which was written by us in our own language, in this very country, is our mandate. Our right in Palestine is as old as the Jewish people. We must have this land.
For us, we don't have to get a piece of paper from the British Mandate or the Ottoman Mandate or from the Romans or from the Greeks. The land is ours. In the Bible it says, this he gave to the Jews. God gave this to the Jews. We are celebrating today, what is it, 5775. This is our new year. Now let's talk about all the rest of the history. When was England born? When was Iraq born? When was Egypt born? The Bible tells us exactly. This is our country. We own it.
In 1937, the Peel Commission published their recommendations. They called for a partition of Palestine. The Arabs would get the larger portion, to be added to Transjordan to form one large Arab state, while the Jews got just one-third of Palestine. Jerusalem would remain under British control, with a corridor to the coast. The Arabs rejected the proposal outright. Most of the Jewish leaders opposed it as well, feeling that they had already given up enough of the land that had been promised to them. But ultimately, Ben-Gurion accepted the terms, a decision that sent shockwaves throughout Jewish Palestine.
Everybody was against it. Why are you agreeing on that? This is not the state of Israel. This is not Israel. The issue is, today I've got nothing. So that is more than what I have now. And that is not the end story. That is the beginning story. He already sees the clouds of the Second World War. He read the book of Mein Kampf that Hitler wrote. He already knew it, and that's one of the reasons that he's talking about it.
Ben-Gurion's decision also sparked controversy in his own family.
One of the people who did not agree to it was his son, my father. And he writes him a letter. And in his letter he says, "Father, how did you agree to the Peel recommendation?" And then Ben-Gurion writes to him a letter. When you read what Ben-Gurion writes, every word counts. And I think that the letter, it draws a great picture of Israel and what his dream of the state of Israel.
"Of course, the partition of the country gives me no pleasure. The question is, would we obtain more without partition? My assumption is that a Jewish state on only part of the land is not the end, but the beginning. We shall admit into the state all the Jews we can. We shall build a multifaceted Jewish economy, agricultural, industrial, and maritime. We shall organize an advanced defense force, a superior army, which I have no doubt will be one of the best armies in the world. A Jewish state must be established immediately, even if it is only in part of the country. The rest will follow in the course of time. A Jewish state will come."
Despite Ben-Gurion's support, the Peel Plan was scrapped after the Arabs rejected it. But just 2 years later, the British came up with another plan that nearly shattered the Jewish dream of statehood. In 1939, the British government issued a document known as the White Paper. Among its main points, Jewish immigration to Palestine would be drastically reduced, then end altogether after 5 years. In addition, the purchase of land by Jews in Palestine would be severely restricted.
The Arabs put such pressure on the British government here that they sealed the borders, which actually condemned millions of Jews to the death camps in Europe because they were knocking on the doors, wanting to come back to their own homeland, but they couldn't because of the British decision, which was a result of the Arab pressure and terrorism.
The British had another big reason to appease the Arabs. On the eve of World War II, they needed to keep control of a crucial oil pipeline that ran from Iraq to Haifa. As war drew closer, the Jews of Palestine faced a dilemma. They obviously couldn't side with the Nazis, but they also felt the British had become their enemies as well. They looked to Ben-Gurion for direction, and his response became their motto throughout the war.
This blow will not subdue the Jewish people. The historic bond between the Jewish people and the land of Israel cannot be broken. We shall fight the war against Hitler as if there were no white paper, and we shall fight the white paper as if there were no war.
As World War II raged in Europe, Ben-Gurion faced a war of his own in Palestine between different factions of the Jewish resistance. 15 years earlier, several Haganah members had formed a splinter group called the Irgun. Their goal was to avenge Arab attacks on Jews and terrorize the British out of Palestine. Their most infamous act was the bombing of the British headquarters at the King David Hotel, which killed 91 people. Ben-Gurion and other Jewish leaders branded the Irgun as a terrorist group and condemned their actions. In 1944, he launched what became known as the hunting season, the roundup and arrest of Irgun members. But by 1947, both the Arab riots and Jewish terrorism proved too much for the British, who were still recovering from World War II.
His Majesty's government have determined that they have based their policy on the assumption that they must lay down the mandate.
In November, the United Nations voted to divide Palestine into two states, one Arab and one Jewish.
United Kingdom, abstain. United States, yes.
The resolution of the Duck Committee for Palestine was adopted by 33 votes, 13 against, 10 abstention.
Once again, Jewish leaders accepted the offer of partition. And once again, the Arabs refused. The British mandate would officially end on May 15, 1948. For Ben-Gurion, it was the right moment to declare a Jewish state. Others around him weren't so sure.
Once he declares the State of Israel, it will not be only the locals, Arabs, that will fight against us, but all the Arab countries around us, they're all going to come after us. George Marshall was the Secretary of State, and Forrestal was the Minister of Defense, for reasons known to them, we know what it is, mainly oil, warned Israelis, tell Ben-Gurion not to declare the State of Israel because of the Americans will not support you. So, what have you got? You've got inside the country, you've got division of opinions. You've got a war before you've got a state, and you've got the Americans, the biggest allies, size-wise,
saying to you, don't declare the state of Israel. So everything is against you.
Facing opposition on all sides, Ben-Gurion took one last shot at diplomacy. Tomorrow on the 700 Club, meet the woman he called the best man in his cabinet and see how she became Israel's last chance for peace with the Arabs.